Good morning. Go ahead and continue your fellowship for the next minute or two. We're going to try to stay on track. Just by way of background, this will be a series of experts that will come one by one, because someone asked, would they have the opportunity to ask questions? And after each presenter, we will take questions. I'm Julia Johnson. I have the honor and privilege of serving on the board and as treasurer for MMTC. And David really set the tone for us this morning, didn't he? He told us our challenges and our opportunities. Well, the purpose of this session will be to roll up your sleeves, look at the issues both vertically and horizontally, determine how can we as a group call to action. I think, Juan, you raised the question of what does this move to action mean? Well, first, it starts with the substance. And the individuals that will speak this morning, and it'll be led by Blair, will start with the broadband plan. We'll hear from content providers. We will hear from entrepreneurs. And we will engage in developing that plan that will help us ensure first-class digital citizenry. So let's give ourselves about a minute to get that last cup of coffee, and then we'll begin the session of experts. Again, was the introduction the state of broadband and social media? Can we give David Honig a round of applause? You know, I'm sitting by the president of Women in Government, Commissioner Daisy Lynham, and throughout your speech, Mr. Honig, she was getting more and more and more excited. Maybe a little anxious. She's ready for the movement to begin. So I can tell you, particularly representing the intergovernmentals, that we have a friend and we have a partner as we move forward in the effort. And I think there's one other thing to kind of complement as a part of that call to action. And that is, it was one in partnership. Understanding all of the obligations that are placed before the FCC and saying that we will take a seat at the table and partner with you, that these issues are important to you, important to us, important to our communities, and important to the nation. And that the only way to achieve is to open up the dialogue and move forward on action. So it was one, and most importantly, one of partnership and moving forward. While we will not always agree on all of the issues, we do agree to work consistently and diligently. And to the extent that there are issues or barriers, we will work with you to remove those barriers, because this is too important not to address. So with that, again, I salute David, and we're ready to roll up our sleeves. And let me give it a little context here for how we intend for this session to flow. In a very methodical way, we put together the panel of experts that will be led by keynote addresses, 10 to 15 minutes, with ample time for Q&A. We thought we would begin with the issue that David raised in his presentation, in compliments of the FCC and Congress and our president, who recognized that we must have a national broadband plan. But not a plan to just sit on the shelf, but one that's full of implementation, one that's focused on communities, one that recognizes that this transformative technology will impact how we educate our children, how we receive health care, how we indeed move this economy forward. And we're doing that through several verticals. The broadband plan, which Blair was smiling because David has never given anybody an A. So we salute you as the architect of that plan. We will hear from Cleveland Spears, who understands old school and new school, as someone who is actively engaged in radio, who has also started a movement in digital media and digital radio, and is an advocate for the issues and a supporter of the causes of MMTC. A view from distribution. Most of you know John Moletta, entrepreneur extraordinaire, who also is well-grounded in public policy, having served several roles at the FCC. A view from cable. What are the carriers? What are the internet service providers bringing to the table? And we've gotten a few questions on the Comcast merger, and we've also had some dialogue around the fund that they've put together. Perhaps we can engage in a little deeper detail on those conversations, particularly since several entrepreneurs have asked about the fund, how will it operate, when will it be available. And during the course, if not this session, but throughout the session, we expect to begin to collect those questions, answer as many as we can, and then move forward again on another exciting initiative. A view from wireless. If you look at the information from the Pew Institute, we recognize that wireless broadband is a powerful technology for women, minorities, and the underserved. And that to the extent that there is a place where we are early adopters, where we are embracing the technology, we're using the technology, then it is wireless. We'll hear from Verizon, a view from wireless, its impact on minorities, its impact on our audiences and our communities and our nature and our nation, as well as I look at David, who's an expert on these issues, how it will impact our future. A view from telecommunications and broadband, no other than Cynthia Marshall. No one can deliver it in a way that she can, as she leads AT&T North Carolina, where she deals with issues of diverse population, with urban as well as rural areas, where she leads from a corporate as well as social responsibility perspective. You'll hear her thoughts, her goals, and her views on how we move forward. And last but not least, we'll hear from Mayor Franklin, and we salute you and your participation today. Hers is a very interesting message. As a two-term mayor from the South, Atlanta, she had the opportunity to see Atlanta and lead Atlanta's growth at its core. She understands infrastructure issues. She understands community issues. And in her role for Alliance for Digital Equality, she has been a champion to say, let's take a step back. Let's look at the technology. And David, the policies that you articulated, she's right on point, saying we have to be at the table. We cannot have those unintended consequences. And we'll hear from her that interplay between the need for digital literacy, the need for jobs, and the infrastructure investment. So we'll round this session off just really to start the conference. It is the beginning of the dialogue. It is the beginning of our challenge. It is the beginning of our program. And with that, I'm going to turn it back over to David, who will introduce our first speaker. Thank you.
Years from now, Blair Levin is going to be remembered as the person who wrote the National Broadband Plan. Well, he and 110 other people who he supervised. Lord, was that hard. Because if you read it, a couple things come to mind. One is this is very dense and it's very broad. Someone had to be able to understand all of that stuff because a lot of it is interconnected to one another. You can't look at intercarrier comp, one of the most mind glazing over subjects I've ever had to try to learn, without understanding its impact on USF reform, which in turn impacts adoption, which in turn impacts how you close the digital divide. Everything is one or two or three degrees of separation substantively in this field. Someone had to be able to see all that. It took a person who is both very caring and very brilliant, and we're about to hear from him. From 1993 to 1997, Blair Levin was chief of staff at the FCC. After you do that, you're supposedly never come back. He did come back after a stint, among other things, as the chief and top investment analyst in this field in the country, really, at Stifel Nicolaus. He came back to be executive director of the Broadband Initiative, incorrectly sometimes called in the trades the Broadband Czar. No, it wasn't. This isn't a throwback to Russia 200 years ago. What it really was a collaborative effort with enormous care and outreach, 40 or so public hearings, several of which were on our issues that we champion and care about, 110 people, 360 pages, and as we said earlier, we're not going to let it gather dust. He is now at the Aspen Institute, and he's here with us today to talk about the view from the National Broadband Plan.
Thank you very much, David. Having returned to the FCC once, I think I understand the wisdom of those who chose never to return. There was a little bit of you can't go home again, but actually we had a great time. In fact, I would say that it was far more than 110 folks, not that I was supervising, but that really there were literally hundreds of folks at the commission who are working on this project. I want to thank you for inviting me back. As some of you might recall, a year ago I spoke here after actually reading the first set of filings for the plan and expressed a lot of frustration with the quality of the filings and because they really lacked a seriousness of purpose. I'm happy to report that subsequent filings did provide an analytic framework and policy recommendations for an agenda for America's broadband future. And I want to particularly recognize this organization and David Honig for helping us understand what needed to be in that agenda. I'm not sure that I deserved an A, but we were quite sincere when we wrote at the beginning of the book that while the staff put this together, the author of the plan really was America itself. As David mentioned, we had a lot of workshops, but in particular, this organization really helped us focus on that agenda and how to address the question of this conference, how to achieve universal first-class citizenship in the digital age. Now, David has 72 recommendations that in some sense go to that. We had a couple hundred recommendations. I'd actually argue almost all of them go to that question. But I'm going to just very quickly talk about five today. It doesn't include, obviously, everything in the plan. There's not enough time. But I wanted to leave you with these five because I think they're representative of what is an important and achievable agenda that ought to be the work for all of us over the next several years. So here are five. Some are obvious, and a couple are kind of counterintuitive. First, reform universal service. This is obvious. The current system is inefficient. It doesn't address broadband. It's heading for a train wreck. And it does nothing for digital literacy, a problem David's talked about and we all understand we have to address. Now, I talked about this in a speech last winter at the Joint Center. Adoption is very different for broadband than for telephone and television. We need far more sophisticated and, frankly, difficult strategies. But without reform, the necessary funds will not be available for that effort. Now, this is important because some have criticized the plan, which does assure that all American homes will have access to a broadband network without new fees, as not providing sufficient speeds to the last 5% of American homes, those in less dense areas. Now, that's a fair question about what that speed should be subsidized, what speed should be subsidized. But to have a reasoned debate, everyone should have to answer three questions. What speed is sufficient? How much will it cost, and how will one pay for it? And when critics are forced to answer those questions, you can see why I'm concerned about resources. I was recently on a panel with a plan critic who advocated that we should have not 4 megabits down, but 100 megabits to 100% of the population. Thank you. So I pointed out that his plan would require every subscriber to the network to pay $30 a month to support the current 5% unserved. He didn't challenge my math. Rather, he said he was fine with such an assessment. Now, I have to say, it takes a very peculiar kind of intelligence to believe that assessing 100% of Americans $30 a month will help achieve universal broadband. Unfortunately, that kind of intelligence is not in short supply. But the path to first-class digital citizenship for all cannot rely on pricing the people represented in this room and the people that you represent, it can't rely on pricing them out of the market, and that's what that $30 assessment would do. So we've got to be very conscious and vigilant that reform provides an acceptable level of broadband to all at an affordable price. And we've got to have the resources to do things like digital literacy programs. Second, reform spectrum management. Now, there's a high probability that without reform, by the middle of this decade, we will have a spectrum crunch in major cities. With the result, broadband that is worse and more expensive than it would be with reform. Now, this is particularly important for minority communities, as Julia just pointed out. Every study, including most recently the Pew study, demonstrates that for minorities, mobile internet is the gateway to the internet. The president recently signed a very important executive order moving the ball forward. Congress and the FCC now have to do their part. Now, some will argue that reform will actually hurt minority communities. It's an argument that only makes sense if you ignore every technology and consumer trend, and you actually ignore consumer behavior, and you think it's wise to base our policies for 2020 on the realities of 1990. Third, we need to provide a gig of connectivity to every community. Now, this would both drive increased speeds generally and improve performance for key public institutions, such as education and healthcare institutions. Now, there's no doubt wealthier areas will achieve this, but it needs to be done in every community. I want to commend Commissioner Clyburn, who's speaking later here, for a recent speech she gave to the Library Association on this topic. Everyone should read it. She laid out a clear path for how we can move forward on this goal. I think it's very important. Now, two non-intuitive but also important recommendations. Establish a national framework for sales taxes on broadband-delivered goods and services. Why is this important? Broadband is not like broadcasting. There's no license, no permission from the government needed to find a way to provide any service or application. It's innovation, not government permission, that creates new services like Google, Facebook, or Quora. We should not, however, kid ourselves that mass application will serve every community's needs. We need innovators who want to address the unique needs of particular communities. The technological path is getting easier, as can be seen in the most recent Google Apps toolkit, but the economics and the unique understanding of communities is not getting easier. One significant barrier for entrepreneurs setting out to serve minority communities is achieving scale. Fortunately, broadband enables reaching that scale by offering services to a multiplicity of similarly situated but geographically diverse communities. But for an entrepreneur, however, facing a multiplicity of taxing authorities can make the task impossible. So state and local governments have to have the right to tax, but small internet-based businesses shouldn't face complex and often conflicting tax requirements. So a national framework called for in a bill recently introduced, called for in the plan, but also in a bill recently introduced by Congressman Boucher and Smith, I think is an important step in the right direction. And the fifth recommendation I'll mention today is one that I guarantee, I'm not really worried about how I'm looked at 25 years from now. I just hope I have a memory, actually, 25 years from now. But I'm certain of this. 10 years from now, this recommendation will be seen as crucial to achieving digital citizenship, and that is we need to replace all textbooks in this country with digital content. Mm. Now, a broadband plan colleague and I laid out Friday in the Washington Post a description of how replacing textbooks could improve education by creating an ecosystem in which parents, teachers, school boards get improved insight into what works for educating our kids, and a platform that is constantly improving. But more important is that this platform would enable all students to learn as much as they can, as fast as they can, in a way that's specifically oriented toward them. And this is the most important ingredient for first-class digital citizenship, development of human capital. When we move from the platform that Gutenberg 500 years ago created to one being created on the broadband platform, every student will develop the tools that will mean a generation from now, everyone will have the ability to be a first-class digital citizen. In closing, I'm more optimistic than I was a year ago, but I remain concerned, as I was a year ago, that we still do not have, as a country, the seriousness of purpose in our discussions of how broadband can benefit from the emerging broadband platform. When I hear, as I often do, that the only important metric for our broadband ecosystem is the speed of the wired network in the most sparsely populated parts of our country, a statement that evidences really a lack of seriousness about the economics, technology, consumer preferences, as well as policy, and I often hear that statement. I feel as I did last July. However, I'm comforted by conferences like this because you've asked the right question, and I have faith that in meetings like this, you all will start to provide that leadership, that energy, and that strength to make sure that the plan does not sit on the shelf and it actually gets implemented. So thank you very much, and I'd be happy to answer any questions that anybody has. Questions? Sure.
I'm curious about your last recommendation and whether there's receptivity among educators for
moving from textbooks to the digital technology, or, I mean, is there a significant discussion with educators about that?
a couple of things. First of all, the answer is yes. There are a lot of educators. I think there is a lot of concern because technology has often been overhyped in terms of the benefits that it can bring for education. And I think if you look at some experiments to date, you find things that are troubling. And for example, there have recently been some studies that showed that when you give kids broadband, they spend all their time on YouTube. Now, to me, that's not the problem isn't broadband. The problem is you haven't created the ecosystem of devices and applications. And as we laid out in the op-ed, if you actually create a system which, for example, as soon as Johnny finishes his homework, his parents know both that he finished it, but also how he did, you create a feedback mechanism that dramatically improves education. If the teacher knows at 9 o'clock every night, as is possible, how many kids did the homework, what problems are most problematic, what they should teach the next day, you create a feedback mechanism. So I think we haven't really had a true test. So there is concern. I think it's also, frankly, there are certain licensing requirements. There are certain kind of concerns by the textbook industry, which, like all industries, has been doing this a lot of years and has a lot of relationships. But I think that's what that is an important fight. I assure you this, that if 5 years from now, kids are putting iPads in their backpacks instead of textbooks, that over time, that digital platform will always improve. And you see this in a lot of classic business texts. What makes a great company is not where they start, but what is the rate of improvement. And so in the same way that there's a lot of, YouTube is a much, much better than it was 5 years ago, or Google answers search queries much better than it did 5 years ago, a digital platform is inherently self-improving in ways that I think are really, really important. Other questions? Yes. Go ahead.
With your investment background,
yes.
You identified 5 areas. What area do you feel would probably be the most attractive to those who have capital ready to invest, and how would that enhance the broadband plan for entrepreneurs?
Well, it's a funny thing. I have a tendency to focus on whatever question I'm being asked, and I've been out of the investment world for about the last 18 months because I was on transition and then I did the broadband plan. I only had a couple months back. And I have to say the investment world has shifted dramatically since then. So I'm a little bit hesitant to say it because people might attribute expertise to me that I don't have. But having said that, I'll say the following. I will tell you that from the perspective of the broadband plan, there were a couple things that were very, very striking. Number one, that the private sector, that everything in the private sector has really started to take advantage of what we might think of as the data revolution. That is to say, the ability to both transfer data, analyze data, look at data in ways that are very, very dramatic. So that, for example, you don't do banking the way you used to, right? You do banking online, you do banking ATMs. You are probably younger than me, but you and I grew up in an age when you used to go get money, you had to go to a bank teller. That's dramatically changed. Many other businesses dramatically changed. Why is Walmart such a huge company? It's because of the way they use information, actually. There are two sectors of the economy that have not changed at all. And what's interesting is they're both fundamentally information sectors. One is education, the other is healthcare. And I think the ability to, and there are a lot of reasons they haven't changed, and part of what the broadband plan was about is changing those sectors. So I think that where you're going to see huge opportunities created will be in applications that are measurable and that really demonstrate success in getting kids to learn. When I do continuing education, when I was on Wall Street, they never gave me a book. They put me in front of a computer that I would do stuff, and then if I didn't understand it, because there were a lot of stuff on Wall Street I didn't understand, there'd be videos and there'd be presentations and there'd be PowerPoints. And so the notion that we're going to be restricted to teaching through, just ink and paper, that's wrong. So education is obvious, healthcare is obvious, energy, huge applications in terms of energy management. So I would say if you look at the last part of the book, it's really on the application side. I think on terms of the network side, there's huge capital costs, it's complicated. I think there are going to be some niche plays in certain industries and certain businesses, but it's I feel a little uncomfortable about that because of some of the complexity about that. Other questions? Well, if not, again, David, thank you so much for your leadership, and Julia, thank you as well for all your leadership over the years in doing all this, and particularly to both of you for helping us develop the plan. And have a great day. Thanks.
We're going to call to the stage next David Don, who is here, I think. David, are you here?
Yes, sir.
There you are. Okay. And as you come forward, let me say a few words about you. David is the Senior Director for Public Policy at Comcast, and when you let that sink in for just a second, that's really pretty high up on the mountain. He is an expert on two subjects very dear to us, and many subjects, but two particularly dear to us. One is the National Broadband Plan and how it's going to be rolled out, and how the recommendations in it are going to play out in the business world, including small business. And he's also had great expertise and works as the subject matter expert in Comcast on the ARRA, the American Recovery and Relief Act, which contains what we spoke of earlier as the broadband stimulus, the $7.2 billion worth of money that is supposed to result in 100% broadband access, but of course it's not the $50 billion we needed, so what can we do with it? He is a leader in the bar on these subjects, which I think says an awful lot about the respect with which he's been afforded by his peers. He served as co-chairs of both the Cable Practice Committee and the Wireless Telecommunications Practice Committee of the Federal Communications Bar Association. And we went to the same law school, but I'm older, so at Georgetown. So, fellow Hoya, thank you so much.
Great, David, thank you.
Okay, please give him a round of applause.
I'm going to go back to my law firm roots and do a PowerPoint presentation. But we'll make it kind of quick, so if you guys have questions. Well, David and Julia, thank you for having me here today. Appreciate the opportunity on behalf of Comcast to speak about a topic that's very important to us, and that's broadband and broadband adoption. I knew I was going to be following Blair today, and I thought also maybe John Mulette and some others. So by the time I got up here, I didn't think it was going to be my goal to tell you how important broadband is to our country. I'm sure the other speakers have made that case and will make that case through the coming days. But what I do want to talk about is what Comcast thinks about broadband and what we're doing to increase broadband adoption, particularly in those areas where extra effort needs to be undertaken to make sure that we're not leaving anybody behind and that broadband is widely adopted and not just widely available. First of all, let me take you back a second to the adoption or the proposal for the National Broadband Plan, which was first, the FCC first saw comment on about a year and a half ago or so. And in those comments, Comcast made clear to the FCC that the biggest problem we have in this country is not one of broadband access, but one of broadband adoption. We told the FCC in our comments that about 92% of Americans have access to broadband, but only about 63% are adopting it. And we thought, unlike what much of the conventional wisdom was, we thought the main issue was how do we get those who have access on the net rather than just focusing, like we often do in telecommunications, on increasing access to those areas that don't have it. And I shouldn't say rather, but at least identifying the adoption problem as probably our number one issue. And about a year later, the FCC released its National Broadband Plan, did its own study and its own research, and its data was entirely consistent with the data Comcast provided it. The FCC found that 95% of Americans have access to broadband, but only 65% of those with access are adopting. And that failure to adopt, that adoption problem, is at least four times as big as the access problem. So the adoption issue is something Comcast cares a lot about because fundamentally we have two interests here. One is a business interest, and this is a business opportunity. There are millions of people whose homes we pass with our service who aren't purchasing broadband. And then, of course, there's a community relations issues, and we believe that broadband is an important part of moving our nation forward and moving our communities forward. So with that, let me take you through just some of the ways we look at this broadband adoption problem. So the FCC study found that 65% of Americans have broadband at home. Right, 65% have broadband at home. But you see that there are certain, so there are 35% who don't. And we're trying to focus on those 35% who could buy it, but don't buy it. And why don't they buy it? Well, fortunately, the FCC did its own study with data that's very similar to some of our own internal polling data. And what they found was that there's education is a barrier. You'll notice all of these different categories are below the national average of 65%. So just quickly walking through it, if your highest education is a high school degree, only 46% have broadband in their home. Incomes below 50,000, 52% have broadband in their home. African Americans are below the national average at 59%, just slightly below, but still below. And Hispanics are at 49%. In addition, Americans with disabilities are at 42% of adoption. And then probably the largest category of non-adopters are the seniors, with only 35% adoption. And none of this is probably particularly surprising to anybody, but the FCC did its own study in February, and these are the groups it found who are below the national average. Now the question is, why are they below the national average? And this excellent study by the FCC asked them, why aren't you adopting when it's available to you? And you might be surprised by some of the results, but this is the FCC's own data. And they found number one reason is that people just aren't comfortable with technology and a computer and the internet. Also, people who are concerned about the online environment. This is a very important issue. As Blair just mentioned, if we're going to bring education into the 21st age and make it digital and online, we're going to have to make parents comfortable that the online environment is safe and secure for their kids. And Comcast does a lot of things in that area. I'd be more than happy to discuss if people wanted to get into that. The second highest reason people aren't subscribing to broadband is relevance. They just don't see the value in it. And again, this is something where if we make the applications, we bring education, we continue to foster applications that people want to use, then we're going to get broadband adoption, which then, of course, will expand, right? You buy it for one reason. You think you wanted it originally to download your iTunes videos, and now people are doing, you're doing your banking online, you're doing your research online, you're gathering your news online. So the key is to make applications that people want, and then we know that'll increase adoption. The third issue was the price of broadband service. 15% say that price is an issue. And that's something that we're addressing, and I'll get into in a moment. What's interesting is, though, of those 15% who said price is an issue, 20% of those said even free wouldn't work. So I don't know how we're going to reach about, that price issue where price may be too much. If you eliminate 20% of that 15%, maybe more like 12% or so, who think that price is the reason they're not buying broadband. Another big issue is the cost of the computer. I think the estimates are about 20% of Americans don't have computers in their homes. So if you don't have a computer, you surely aren't going to have broadband. And one of the issues on computers is cost of the computer. Finally, the last point is just another cost-related issue, like I guess an installation cost. This one was a little less clear to me, and the notion of signing a contract, which some companies require and some companies don't. And finally, you see the other reason 35% are adopting, about 5% don't have access. So while we spend a lot of time in this country talking about universal service, which is important, and getting rural access online, what you see is the universal service, the rural access issue, is probably the smallest issue for not adopting. It's about 5%, whereas the other 30% or so are choosing not to buy it for some of these reasons, and that's the issue we're trying to address at Comcast. So what are we doing? We have up here, you'll see, what, 2, 4, 6, 8 programs. I'm going to go through them kind of quickly, give you a sense of the things we're doing to address each of those issues. And we've been working on these issues for probably a good 5, 6 years now. Our number one priority, and it's a program we take a lot of pride in, and you guys, some of you may have heard about in the audience, which it's very important to us, is our Digital Connectors program. Digital Connectors is a partnership with One Economy. One Economy is an organization we think does a great job of grassroots technical education, technological education, and they're great partners. I should take a step back and say, our priorities are working with in partnership with others. We know we can't solve the problem. Our number one goal is to run a business, to put out broadband, to put it out there. But working with organizations like One Economy, we know we can partner and promote broadband adoption. So what is the One Economy program? One Economy program is right now in, I think we're going to be in 30 locations by the end of the year. I think we're at about 20 locations now. We work with communities. We go into these communities with One Economy. We provide them the funding, and they put together programs where they bring young adults, teenagers, 16, 17, 18 years old, intensive technology training 3 days a week, and turn them into what I think One Economy calls technological evangelists. And these people get the training, but that's not the end of it. They obviously get training. They also get hardware and software, about $6,000 worth of computer gear and software before they leave the program. But then they go back in their communities. They're not just taking the knowledge themselves and obviously bettering themselves and getting a better education and improving their job prospects and their computer training, but they're taking it back to their families, they're taking it back to their neighborhoods, they're taking it back to their schools, and they're teaching others what the value is of online and also how to be safe online. What are the risks of being online? You have to, it's, you know, safety is a very important issue, and we get that a lot in all of our surveys. And we train our, or One Economy trains these students to how to surf safely, how to search safely, and take this back to their community. So this is our number one priority. We think One Economy is a great organization, and we think they're doing a heck of a good job. One of the things about One Economy that we do, so in addition to funding them, a partnership we created with them about 2 years ago, One Economy is obviously, I think, building on the success of our Digital Connectors program, has taken to other ISPs and to other cable companies. And what they did in April was seek federal funding through the stimulus to obtain an additional $28 billion for broadband education and adoption training. If they receive that funding, which I think we're pretty, I don't want to say confident, you can't be sure, but we understand they're getting good reviews in the government review, 40 additional sites over the next 2 years. And that's incredible. Already in 2 years, I think our program has trained anywhere from 250 to 300 young teens. And if you look at the markets One Economy is in, it's primarily major metropolitan areas, urban areas, Baltimore, Washington, Philadelphia, Boston, Hartford, Miami, Houston, Portland. These are the areas that have the biggest broadband adoption. You saw who's not adopting, and these are the areas of major areas that we're targeting. And let me just be honest with you, as the cable industry, again, in this country, we spend a lot of time focusing on rural areas, but cable is primarily an urban product. It is. We don't generally run, cable has historically not been very rural. It has been the telcos who have received government subsidies for 75 years or 80 years who have built out in these rural areas. We are primarily in major metropolitan areas and the suburbs. You know, we're building out more, but you don't generally find cable to be a very rural product, and we target our adoption programs in these areas. What else are we doing? So in addition to making broadband relevant and to providing digital literacy, we are trying to address the cost issue. There's no doubt for some people, cost is a barrier to adopting broadband. So what are we doing? Just this year, the cable industry announced a partnership with other ISPs and with One Economy, and I think with the support, and I know with the support of HUD, the Housing and Urban Development Agency, to promote broadband adoption and bring low-cost broadband to 250,000 government-supported housing units nationwide. So what is the deal there? For a two-year program, which is, I think, the boundaries of the stimulus, it has to be a two-year program to receive stimulus funding. For a two-year program, consumers receive 50% off the internet retail rates, 50% off of equipment costs, and free installation. So if you saw there that some people don't want to buy it for price, some people are worried about service contracts, hardware costs, and installation costs, this is meant to address that for some of the poorest American citizens. We don't know yet if this program will receive the federal funding. We are optimistic, and hopefully it will. And as I note here, if this program goes forward, any Comcast subscriber who gets this will save about $600 over 2 years. And the cable industry in total contribution could be as high as $570 million over these 2 years. So again, we're trying to address each of the problems. This one addresses cost. What else are we trying to address? We saw there are clearly socioeconomic issues that drive why customers or why Americans aren't taking broadband when it is available. One of the things we're doing in Philadelphia, our hometown, we've worked with the Urban League in Philadelphia to build a technology center, a 38,000 square foot technology center. It, like the One in Kind program, brings teens in, trains them, and then makes them out in their sends them out to their community to teach others and make that grow exponentially. We've done that in Philadelphia, where we graduated 20 students 1 year and 17 the next. And then we're also doing that in Detroit and southeastern Michigan. And also working with LULAC to reach out to the Hispanic community as well, opening two tech centers similar to the one in Philadelphia. Finally, last week, we announced with many other ISPs something called Project Goal. You may be hearing more about it today. I think it got a lot of attention last week. And this is to get older Americans online. This is clearly a challenge. It's one of generation, it's their experience, and it's also one of what is there to do online for older people. They have a different, they're not into YouTube as much, right? I mean, I don't want to generalize or stereotype, but the applications just aren't there which are driving adoption. But we need to get them there. As Blair probably mentioned, and I know the National Broadband Plan says, we need to get healthcare online, we need to get government services online, and that those products clearly target the elderly. But if they don't have computers, they don't have broadband access, we're not going to be able to take advantage of all of these applications we're talking about. So, and then also last week, Broadband for America, a coalition of probably about 150 companies, announced three grants in the New York City area, two elderly centers, or senior centers, I should say, to provide adoption training. So finally, we're reaching out to our community. We're going around and reaching out. We particularly have a targeted program for Hispanics, where we are going to Hispanic communities and Hispanic events and telling them about all of our products, and broadband is clearly a part of that. Now, let me just finish by saying this is not all about altruism. This is about business, as you might imagine. We're here to primarily, it's a revenue-generating operation, I think my boss would like me to say. But we do believe that community relations is an important factor of this. And we see the issues. The FCC laid them out for us. Now it's our responsibility, along with the government and other public agencies, to address these problems. Thank you for your time. Any questions?
Any questions?
All right, David, when are you coming to Orlando? I'm your partner.
What? Let me see what the map says, because I don't have them all memorized. I'm sorry. Man, Orlando isn't even on the map. I will take that. How's that? That's the best I can do right now. It's not going to be in 2010. That's all I know. I'm sorry. But I will. I don't know how these markets are picked with one economy and their priorities. I don't know what their presence, their connections are there. Actually, Orlando's also not a major Comcast area now that I think about it. Well, fair enough. We'll have to look. We'll put Orlando on the map, and I'll raise out One Economy. But it's mostly their driving. And Julia will remind me that Orlando is an important market for us. Thank you.
David, I was going to take you off the hot seat. I'm with Bright House, and Orlando is actually our market. I'd love to talk to anybody who's interested in looking at programs in our footprint.
Well, I'm sure One Economy would want to partner with you guys as well.
David, I was curious. I live in Philadelphia. This isn't a Philadelphia-related question, but related to initiatives that are directed at the schools, availability of access in the schools, hardware in the schools for students and for instructors. I didn't really hear anything in your initiatives that are directed towards the educational system.
Right. So we often, very often, I mean a very high percentage of our franchise areas, we provide free broadband access to the schools. There are challenges in getting schools. Many schools are older and not wired. Now with Wi-Fi being prevalent and high capability, we're seeing that addressed. There were problems years ago where we would obviously take one line to the school, bring a broadband connection to school, but it couldn't get into the classroom. That's being addressed now, I think, through Wi-Fi. Most of that is done on a very local level with the franchise area, but we often, it's a very high percentage, 80-90% of the markets we're in, we're wiring schools, we're wiring libraries. But there is a hardware problem, and the federal government addressed that, understood that as far back as 1996 with the E-rate program, which did provide funding for some of these subsidies of getting it into the classroom, not just to the school building. I don't know if we have any specific programs, I'll be honest, that is targeting on a nationwide level, sort of at corporate headquarters level, that we know we're putting computers in schools. But locally, we probably have a lot of programs where we work with others who are putting computers in the classroom. But we are bringing broadband to the schools. And I think we're bringing broadband not just to the school, but to the classroom, which is a big step forward and something that's probably just happened in the last 5 or 6 years. But that is a challenge. Blair talked about education, and the future is clearly going to be driven by broadband. We're going to need to do that. The One Economy program, I should note, also provides hardware and gives netbooks to all of the students who go through that. So a netbook, is a $400 computer nowadays, and that really is a major advantage. Sure. Right. I think One Economy primarily is focused on the major metropolitan areas. I don't think we are, at the moment, there's a lot of demand and need in these major metropolitan areas. I'm not sure what, we'd have to, if you looked at the One Economy application, if they receive this $28 million of federal funding, which, they're on the track to hopefully get, they're going to get 40 new markets. I have a feeling some of those will start going out more into the rural areas. There clearly is a need for digital education and accessibility in these rural areas as well. I don't mean to say there isn't, but our focus tends to be more in these major metropolitan areas. Well, thank you for your time. Julia and David, good luck with the rest of your conference.
Thank you.
Thank you, David. Excellent presentation. And to some of the questions, there are some other programs out there, Alliance for Digital Equality, Engaged in Digital Literacy and Outreach as well, Connected Nations. They're also looking at programs both in urban and in rural areas. Most of the carriers also have programs that are targeting both. When Ms. Marshall speaks, when you look at a state law like North Carolina, she'll explain the need to make sure that we reach out to all of those communities and the different type programs that they have available for those communities. We're going to shift gears a little bit and hear from Mr. John Maletta. John Maletta is one of those individuals who understands technology at the edge, but who's a brother who can also tell you he knows it at both ends as well. He understands the business and the politics. He's the CEO and founder of M2Z Networks, a broadband internet access company. Mr. Maletta has a distinguished career, having served as the bureau chief for the FCC Wireless Bureau. Under his leadership, the commission's policies regarding consumer wireless services and public safety radio networks were addressed. He implemented the major programs under those sections. He also served in several capacities at the Common Carrier Bureau as well. He has a distinguished career as an entrepreneur, having served as a senior officer with PSINet, a leading commercial internet service provider, and he serves on the board of Fibertown, HRS Smart, a privately held human resources application services provider, ranked one of the fastest growing companies by Inc. magazine. With that, I introduce to you John.
I'd give David a kiss, but, that's well, thank you very much. I really appreciate it. I've been a longtime supporter of MMTC, both before M2Z as well as once we started M2Z. I started the company, give you a little bit of a background before we get to the heart of the discussion today. We started M2Z Networks as a new wireless broadband provider because there's, despite what you might have heard from my dear friend David Don, There's actually not enough competition, and there was an opportunity to sort of create a new way of doing things with the support of three of the best venture capitalists in North America, Kleiner Perkins, which helped found Google, Amazon, among other companies, another firm by the name of Charles River Ventures, and Redpoint Ventures. Charles River Ventures is mostly in the technology space. Redpoint, you might recognize some of the names, TiVo, MySpace, and Excite, were all companies that were created by our friends at Redpoint Ventures. So what we did about 4 years ago is we discovered that the market had a number of problems. One was that there wasn't enough competition in terms of broadband itself. There's actually a distinction that might be erased over time, but today there is a distinction between broadband and wireless. So in the broadband market, it's actually a duopoly on a geographic basis between telephony and cable, in terms of wireless is beginning to make an inroads, but that was an opportunity that we saw about 4 years ago. The second thing is what we saw, and this is the heart of the discussion that I'll have today about distribution, is that the marketplace is kind of changing in a couple of different and very important ways. One is that it is going to be a market of connected devices and not about subscribers. So you're going to still have a subscriber, but they're going to have multiple devices. They're all connecting to their broadband internet, okay? And so one of the questions you have is, how do I enable all these devices that are connected to the internet sort of unfettered access and frictionless access, which is the second point. The other trend that we saw is that there's a need in the marketplace for frictionless access to broadband services, actually to all kinds of digital services. And what we mean by frictionless is essentially eliminating all the things that sort of get in the way of the buying behavior. So if you ask people, would you like to sign a 2-year contract? That's a friction. Would you like to have an early termination fee for $150, $300? That is a friction. So when you add up all these things, what we saw in the market was that the friction kept people from subscribing to broadband. The numbers we had 4 years ago are slightly larger than what they are today, so the market has improved, but not that much. 4 years ago, we argued there was roughly about 100+ million people that weren't subscribing to broadband. When I went to the FCC at one time, I was told, John, are you trying to solve a problem that doesn't exist? Different administration. The results of the study of the National Broadband Plan is that there is actually 100 million people for whom price and relevance and friction is a huge issue. So in a different administration, the problem has been recognized. What does M2Z want to do? M2Z wants to take some fallow spectrum that the U.S. government has that has sort of been sitting on it, depending on how you count the years, anywhere from 7 to 10 years. It's basically residual spectrum. It is a spectrum that nobody's figured out what to do with it. And what we want to do is use that to create a nationwide broadband wireless competitor. There's some technology, unique technologies that are available called beamforming, smart antennas, that can be applied on this really unique piece of spectrum that can give you increases in speed and increases in range. So those are the two limitations of wireless, and allow you to compete with wireless, with broadband, sort of wired broadband services. So what we've done is try and build a plan and get support behind it, investment support, to create this new competitor. This new competitor would provide a 6 megabit wireless broadband service. This would be connecting people essentially at what cable modem does today. Now, again, wired services have the ability to increase their speed over time because they are wired and they don't have the sort of physics problem that wireless does, but this service would provide 6 megabits of wireless broadband service. As a matter of public policy, we've also committed to provide a free broadband service at roughly 768 kilobits of broadband service to any person who's willing to buy the device to connect to the network. So 4 years into the process, a year and a half into the new administration, unfortunately, we have not had a decision on what to do with the spectrum. Clearly, if there are other ideas that are better, we encourage people to bring them forward. Right now, we have not heard any better plan that addresses the entire suite of public policy issues. So we're still waiting. One of the things that Blair talked about is the spectrum management process needs to be reformed. If you also look at the universal services aspect of reform, we are going to be asked to foot a significant bill as American consumers to help solve the broadband divide, okay? By ranges based on the national broadband team, it could be anywhere from $35 to $350 billion that is taxpayers either fronting it from U.S. Treasury, which is highly unlikely, or through the universal services mechanism, which is essentially a sort of a consumer assessment that happens through the carriers to provide these services. So that is a lot of dollars. By providing a free nationwide broadband service through the licensing mechanism, the FCC record shows that you could save about half of the cost over a long period of time, of sort of 10 to 20 years, depending on how you account for it, about half the cost of the increased need to connect people to broadband. Now, one of the other things that we've learned is that a lot of people that don't subscribe to broadband, they do it because of price, and the other thing they do is because of relevance. And one of the things we know as internet entrepreneurs is relevance is actually based on experience. So even if it's a low speed relatively to the 6 megabit premium service, getting people connected and having the experience of the benefits of broadband access, remember this is always on. This is an always on service. So this is not like you have to sit there, and even with the 3G services today on wireless, you sort of have to sit and wait for it to dial up. What we provide is an always on service, so you're constantly able to sort of connect to the internet with no waiting time. That really materially changes the experience of people. So getting people connected at any rate, if it's a true always on broadband service, will make an enormous difference in terms of making this relevance. In terms of affordability, a free service is plain in that aspect. So I think in terms of distribution, I want to go back to the two things that are really changing the marketplace today. One is that as you've seen over the last 3 years with Apple, I think the devices are taking over. So it's about devices and it's not about an individual subscriber. So think about some of the regulatory reform that the FCC is talking about. You're going to have set-top boxes that will have access to the internet. What are they going to use to connect to the internet? They could use cable, obviously, or they could use a wireless broadband service to connect to that. You have the iPad and the tablet sort of storm that's taking over. These are essentially, you know, sort of visual display mechanisms. They're not really the standard device, a desktop device, or the standard handset. It's something of a hybrid that the tablets are creating. And Apple has sold, I think, over 4 million in the last month. Okay, and that, you know, if I can't do the charts justice, but if you understand the kind of import that it has, what this means is that devices have taken over. People are going to have multiple devices. What happens when you have multiple devices? You become very sensitive to the pricing mechanism that is available to you. You are not, I believe, going to spend $90 times 4 devices to connect all your devices. So you're going to figure out ways of connecting your laptops, your tablets, your handsets, your set-top boxes, your desktop machines. And what you, as a consumer, are going to do is look for a menu of pricing plans that make it attractive. We believe strongly as M2Z, as a Silicon Valley-based company, that we have an important role both as the premium service at 6 megabit as well as a 768 kilobit free service as being a phenomenal option for people in a connected device world. Again, I don't know if I mentioned it earlier, but when you look at this shift, one of the things that you have to understand is even the big carriers are beginning to understand that. AT&T in its last quarterly report changed the metric. Didn't quite change the metric, but it suggested a new metric for financial analysts. Let's not look just at ARPU, which is average revenue per user. They're now looking at the number of connected devices on the AT&T network. Machine to machine is an exploding area where it's all machines that are talking to other machines, keeping track of the room temperature, keeping track of the outside temperature, keeping track of who's walking in and out, thermal sensors. All of these devices are going to be connected to the network. So when we talk about consumer empowerment, we should remember that it is about the devices and the number of devices that consumers will have. You know, solving just simply the initial connectivity is no longer going to be enough. We have to solve for the multiple devices that reduce your energy, costs that reduce your travel time, that give you mapping, that give you your, not just you, but your children, access to the internet in a safe and responsible manner and at an affordable cost. The second point from a distribution perspective, and I think I've raised this before, but I'll reiterate it before I close, is that it is about friction. There is a prime example in the wireless space about friction and also in the broadcast space about friction. I'll start with most people in town in Washington have a reaction to when you talked about broadcast because it comes with all this stuff around it. But let me mention, I'm watching Jane Mago as I say that, so let me start off by saying in 1999, the number of cellular subscribers was roughly 100 million or so. That's cellular subscribers. In that year and the following two or three years, basically a change happened in the wireless mobile, the voice mobile market, which is that you started entering into bucket pricing. So you get a single price, $40 for 1,000 minutes. It wasn't that generous at that time, but generally it was easy to understand for the consumer. What am I getting for my one price? The second thing that happened was the prepaid market. And the prepaid market didn't ask you for your credit, didn't know where you lived, didn't care. You could buy it at 7-Eleven. Okay, and some of these things evolved, but essentially the prepaid market was created. And when you put those things, what happened? The subscription or the number of subscribers zoomed up to 300 million. I was at a McDonald's one day and I saw a young lady that had two cell phones in it, yet a lot younger, she's like 18. I have two devices myself because one is a company device and the other one is a personal device, something I had to do when I was at the FCC to make sure my two lives didn't intersect and I didn't have to file forms and all this kind of stuff. But I asked a young lady, I said, why do you have two devices? She said, this is for one guy, this is for the other guy. Okay, now, we're talking about connected devices without friction, without people knowing where you are, what you're doing. So anyway, with all jokes aside though, that is how you get adoption to happen. If you ask people that are essentially price sensitive, that are not quite sure about the relevance of things, you've got to reduce the price, but you've also got to make it frictionless, okay? And eventually in any market, as you get to saturation, you will get to these types of new models. The question is, can the commission, through various decisions, accelerate that? We think what M2Z has proposed is one of the most frictionless ways that you can get people to subscribe. It is also an innovative aspect of it, and is also sort of taking in place what the future of the marketplace will look like. In Silicon Valley, there's something called a freemium, okay? And a freemium is, people don't get onto your network until they just sort of have a nibble or a taste. And then they move on to the premium because they've sorted out, hey, it's really relevant to me. Some people never go beyond, some people go deeper into that, into whatever model you're doing this. The question I ask you is, would anybody use Google if you thought you were getting charged $10 in 1997? Would it have taken off? No, because there were actually services that provided the same amount of information. If you went to law school, you remember Westlaw and what's the other one, LexisNexis? What did they do when you were in law school? For those of you that didn't go to law school was like a free food fest, like it was a cafeteria, right? LexisNexis gave you all you can eat every day. You could download all the content you wanted. The minute you went to a law firm, right, the charges came in, $1,000 for some simple research you were doing, and you were like having to explain to the partner, I thought it was free. No, it isn't. Okay, but what it is gets people to learn and experience in a frictionless way, gets them on there, and then when you're on the other side, you need a mechanism for lowering costs through competition and through innovative pricing models. So with that said, I was asked to talk about distribution. I hope this has been relevant as you consider all the public policy debates you're gonna hear and all the commercials you're gonna hear from people like me about their services. In Silicon Valley, we're really working on the distribution angle. So thank you very much, and I'd be happy to answer questions.
Thank you. John, as usual, an excellent presentation. I think we have our first question from Juan. And Juan, we probably should, if you could, state who you're with. That'd be wonderful. State who you're with, the president of the National Hispanic Entrepreneurs Association. Yes, please.
Yeah, my question is, my name is Juan Giometti, the National Hispanic Entrepreneur Organization. You mentioned that relevance comes with experience, right? So, you know, as you said, I think that many times, you know, the problem with low-income populations, I think that maybe I'm asking you, maybe you have the answer, is there any way that we can come up with more innovative ways to deliver the service? Like, I'm thinking, for example, ATMs, right? Like, you were talking about devices. What about shutter devices? Because devices are more like personal. Mm-hmm. So subscription are more like personals. But sometimes devices can be like magazines. You can sell one magazines that are you for four people. When you see in the newspaper industry, the way that they measure readership is for every newspaper, we have four readers. So I'm thinking like maybe there are opportunities to create devices or ways to deliver services that one device can be shared for four people. So in that way, they can have a taste.
Sure.
Just to give an example, Zipcar in the car industry, they are thinking about how they can share the car here in DC, for example, so people can rent a space because they don't need to have the car full day. So I'm wondering if there is any type of innovation that can be deployed in that sector.
It's absolutely a great question, and I think that is the kind of innovation that we're seeing in Silicon Valley. But one of the fundamental problems that device makers and application makers have is that access to the network is very difficult. You know, so in communications, right, you got to have both the network and the devices sort of be married together. And there's all this debate about open devices and open applications. And I think that's the crux of the problem is you can't figure out, you know, the networks are closed and it's very expensive to access them for your device. And so therefore your ability to innovate on the edge is going to be very problematic. I'll give you a sort of a real life example. I was working with a company that wanted to use traffic data and integrate it into a small sort of GPS-like device, but it was about people that had difficulty commuting because of traffic. So they wanted to create a specific application. They essentially had to exit the business. They were venture-backed in Silicon Valley because when they went to the network said, we're going to charge you the same amount of money that we're going to charge any standard wholesale, you know, customer contract we have. And the company said, I can't afford to do that model. It's very expensive. And it took me 18 months to figure out who to talk to within this large organization whose name I won't mention, but is now doing connected devices. But anyway. So I think part of the problem is there's lots of creativity about applications. One of my favorite companies that has been funded by Charles River Ventures, it has Marty Cooper and Arlene Harris. They are wireless entrepreneurs from many, many years back. And Frank Marty sort of credited with the first call in 1970 being made on a cell phone, one of the bricks. but they created a company called Jitterbug. Have you ever seen Jitterbug or read about it? And it's in the wireless space. It's not really broadband. It's just a wireless phone service. They were able to use a sort of a regulatory opportunity to enter the business. But one of the things it has is it's a large phone, right, with big numbers, with lighting behind it. And all you do with it is you call. And it is specifically aimed at a senior population. And the pricing model reflects that. So it's like $10 a month and you know, some per minute usage charges, because the behavior set in that community is you only use it if it's truly an emergency, right? You're not like, you know, when you're much younger, you use it as a social connection. But people were able to develop that by using a regulatory arbitrage as opposed to having a community that welcomes those kinds of applications. Verizon has announced that they have an LTE, which is a technology standard development center. One of the things that the FCC did in auctioning off the 700 megahertz spectrum in 2008 was to have an open platform standard. And as a result of that, I think Verizon has opened up that ecosystem. So it's very hard for me to tell you what those applications are. But what I want is an environment that welcomes that, that says language does make a difference in adoption, that does recognize that we have different living arrangements depending on where you're from and so on and so forth. Any other questions? All right, well, thank you very much, and good luck with your conference. I'll be here tomorrow.
Thank you, John. And I think yours was a good segue and a wonderful tee up for David Hill. At the beginning of the remarks, we had the opportunity to talk about the power of wireless technology, particularly for minority communities and the underserved, including seniors. David is an expert on the issue, and he represents Verizon, and he'll speak on behalf of Verizon Wireless. As the Vice President and Associate General Counsel for Federal Advocacy with Verizon Communications, he is a part of and leads Verizon's Public Affairs, Public and Communications Group in developing and implementing the company's advocacy efforts with the Obama administration and with influential third-party groups. Since joining Bell Atlantic in 1994, Hill has been heavily involved in Verizon's efforts at both the policy and operations levels. Prior to that, he was an attorney with Hogan Hartson, Washington's largest law firm. He's a graduate of Harvard Law School and is a DC insider with insight on both politics and the operations of Verizon Wireless. With that, Mr. Hill.
It is a little bit dicey. Thank you. Julia and David, thank you very much for having me again this year. I had the opportunity last year to speak at this conference, and that last year began a number of very important relationships for me personally as well as professionally. A number of folks I see in the room I first met last year at MMTC. How do we achieve universal first-class citizenship in the digital age? From a wireless perspective, I would humbly suggest the best way to do so is to stay out of the way of things that are already currently taking place. I know it sounds a tad bit self-serving, but perhaps from my perspective at Verizon. However, if you take a look at some of what's going on in the marketplace, I think you see the type of progress that we want to find ways to continue and not impede. As the National Broadband Plan made clear, as Blair spoke about a little bit earlier, the use of mobile broadband is growing dramatically, and it's a critical component of the United States economy today. And with some of the things that John Mulleta spoke about, some of the developments in the industry, it's only going to increase going forward. Earlier this month, the Pew Center released its most recent survey results on the study of wireless and use of mobile devices. Some of that's been talked about earlier, but some of those facts bear repeating. 59% of all adults today go online wirelessly, whether it's using a laptop with a Wi-Fi connection, or a mobile broadband card, or using the internet for email or instant messaging on a cell phone. The results of the Pew survey show that the use of non-voice data applications has grown significantly just since 2009. But perhaps most important for the constituencies that MMTC focuses on and cares most about, our communities and our people continue to outpace white Americans in the use of mobile services. And that is something that I think hasn't been focused on enough in the overall debate, but I think needs to become a critical component as we figure out ways to move these communities forward, our people forward, in terms of the use of broadband. And it's not just the adoption of broadband, but the use of broadband. Nearly two-thirds of African Americans are on, and Latinos are wireless internet users today. We're far more likely to own these devices. You know, it appears that many of the reasons for non-adoption, price, relevance, that we've talked about a little bit already, may not be, and I say may not be, I think it's worth additional study, but may not be similar impediments in the wireless space as they are in the wired space. Now, we are, as Julia mentioned, early and often adopters of wireless broadband. Wireless is the gateway to the internet for our communities. And I think, again, there are things that can be done that are being looked at that really need to become more a part of the discussion. I recall at an earlier conference I think it was David back at Howard earlier this year when I asked a question about whether wireless had been focused on in terms of the national broadband plan, and I don't think it might have been Blair, it might have been somebody else, I don't recall, but it was kind of shunted aside. I respectfully submit to you all, we can't shunt aside the focus on wireless as we move forward in trying to figure out the issues that really matter to all of us. So given the confluence of focus on the need for and the benefits of broadband adoption and usage, wireless has got to be that critical pathway. Now, it's significant to point out everything that's taken place to date. All the growth has been based on 3G networks. That was the past. The future's coming. Verizon, later this year, will begin its implementation of our 4G LTE network in 30 markets, covering approximately 100 million users. By the end of 2013, we'll cover our entire current 3G network, covering 285 million subscribers. And lest I be too parochial, it's not just Verizon deploying 4G. There are Sprint already out there with a 4G network. There are other 4G networks coming. These networks will provide the ability and provide speeds that match today what you see in the wired context. So the whole analysis of what the marketplace looks like is about to shift, because you're going to be able to do far more than you were able to do before. And again, I don't know that it's been sufficiently studied. I know I've spoken to Dr. Nicole Turner-Lee at the Joint Center. They're looking at the issue, but I don't think we've seen a lot about the impact of mobility on the usage patterns, on the adoption patterns. But a lot more of that, I suspect, is going to be coming. If I'm back before you next year talking about this topic, I think there's going to be a lot more to say about that. But with 4G networks, things that you can't do today, video chats, media sharing, social networking, distance learning, remote medical diagnostics, video streaming will all be possible over your mobile devices on a 4G network. Now, John mentioned it earlier, and it bears repeating. Verizon has, in fact, pursuant to what the FCC has done, but also pursuant to what we think is good business, our open development initiative is currently looking to certify non-proprietary devices on Verizon's network. Currently, to date, we've certified well over 100 devices, that effort being led by Tony Lewis, VP inside of Verizon. Continues daily, and as we get the 4G network rolled out, as we better understand what's going on in our marketplace, as we better understand what's going on with our folks, there'll be more of that. That's one way that we'll continue to pursue and achieve first-class literacy, digital literacy in the digital age. Now, I suggest to you all of this will happen, and I don't want to go too far into a policy debate, but all of this will happen unless what, you might ask? Well, unless there's an elephant in the room that hasn't really been talked about. David, I missed the breakfast, so maybe you touched on it when I got here late, but there's a lot of oxygen in the room, in the area, and inside the Beltway, being currently sucked up at the FCC and in the public policy space on the issue of Title II reclassification of broadband networks and or the net neutrality regulations applied to wireless. And I suggest that a lot of what's happening may not happen at the same speed. A lot of the benefits that are being brought to the marketplace may not come to the marketplace as quickly. If we have to continue to deal with that debate, and if the results of that debate lead to undue and unwarranted regulation on wireless broadband networks. And I'm going to stop there, Julia. I could go further into that debate, but if somebody wants to ask questions about that or anything else I've said, I'm just going to stop there. I have more on it, but I think I'll just stop there.
Okay. Very good.
I actually have a question. It's surprising to many people, and one of the few success stories that we really have, that minority adoption of and use of wireless to connect to the internet actually over-indexes that of most Americans. What do you attribute that to?
I mean, this is David Hill speaking from what I think is a common sense perspective, not in the basis of any Verizon wireless analysis. I think we find greater uses of the wireless device. I mean, John mentioned the young lady at McDonald's who had two devices to keep her social life straight. I honestly think, though, I mean, that it's that's somewhat funny, but I think the root of that is what's going on. We see far more uses of this in our day-to-day lives. We quickly get it, we grasp it, whether it's being able to communicate through instant messaging, and I think it starts there, but it's a way to stay in touch with folks while we're on the go. We are an increasing mobile society, and that's the reality that I was speaking of earlier, David. I think that we need to look at that. The whole policy debate kind of had to take, and I give Blair and the FCC credit, they had to start from where they were 18 months ago. We didn't have the same developments. A lot of things have changed since then, but I do think going forward, greater focus needs to be brought on the mobility piece, but I think the reason for the greater adoption is the greater interest in what it can do for us on a day-to-day basis. And so you've seen not just in smartphone devices, but the growth of the prepaid wireless network, prepaid wireless market, and I think you're going to see continued focus on that. Those price points are less than my BlackBerry or that other device, that iPhone thing. But people are using it. People are adopting it. Hi, Carol. Hi, Tanya. But people are using those. They're finding a way, whether it's prepaid or otherwise, to get on mobile and use mobile in their daily lives. And I think that that's because it's closer to them in a way that using a computer and having to understand what it does just isn't the same. So there's the relevance piece is clearer for folks. And I think the price thing disappears a little bit because people do have, many people have more than one device. So it's not, I think everything needs to be restudied when you start talking about the growth of the wireless market.
Any other questions?
I'm sorry, we're capped on...
As far as like streaming audio or streaming materials?
In the 3G? In the 3G, that's true. 4G, that's going to change a little bit. Even 4G, it'll go up a little bit. Even 4G, there may be some caps, but I think you'll see you're able to do a whole lot more than you can do today on the 3G network once 4G is rolled out.
Final question? Seeing none?
Thanks all. Thank you.
I have the honor of bringing Cynthia Marshall to the stage, and what an honor it is. As you see from your program, she is the president of AT&T North Carolina. How do you get to be president of AT&T North Carolina? Well, you work in the business for 30 years. You be the best at what you do all of those years, and you rise up through the ranks, and you become president. That's how you do it. It's that simple. Because she's been in this business since 1981, when she joined Pacific Bell. What do you do when you get there? Well, among other things, you put an end to redlining in your company. You become the leading company practically in your state in terms of minority and women employment and diversity, and you become the leading company in your state in terms of education and educational initiatives. Yes, we're going to be giving her an award for that later on. Yes, she really deserves it. And what happened on the way, she'll tell you about her journey. Cynthia, please come forward.